If you have ever had the misfortune of commenting on a research application, at least for any of the large grant-giving bodies, you will have encountered inappropriate uses of the term paradigm shift. Such applicants usually misunderstand the term and grossly exaggerate their own abilities, while displaying a basic ignorance of Thomas Kuhn's most influential work, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, published in 1962. Historians frequently repurpose less commonly used words to label complex concepts, allowing them to move between analysing the concept and employing it to understand something else. So it is here with paradigm. But I will not attempt a definition yet. I want to begin by explaining the model into which that term fits. The book is concerned with explaining empirical observations, the first of which is the remarkable progress made by the academic disciplines we collectively call sciences, or, as Kuhn phrases it, to a very great extent, the term science is reserved for fields that do progress in obvious ways. How does that happen? All academic disciplines begin as competing schools, and most remain so. This stage is characterized by constant questioning of the goals and methods of the discipline. At some point, the discipline acquires one or more paradigms around which it coalesces. Leaving the definition of paradigm aside, the existence of one allows the field to conduct what Kuhn calls normal science. That is characterized by its focus. The areas investigated by normal science are minuscule, a small range of relatively esoteric problems. Scientists investigate some part of nature in a detail and depth that would otherwise be unimaginable. That process of extremely narrow investigation is both very fruitful and also a threat to the paradigm that permits it. The majority of results reinforce that paradigm, demonstrating its utility. But a small number are anomalies. A single anomaly, a problem that should fit but doesn't, is not an issue. The build-up of enough is, and has a consequence. In all these cases, the awareness of anomaly had lasted so long and penetrated so deep that one can appropriately describe the fields affected by it as in a state of growing crisis. The occurrence of crisis causes a field to fracture, and there are generally three things that can happen. The problem can get worse, the field can further fracture and begin to question its own methods and the possibility of progress, or the anomalies might be sufficiently resolved to allow a return to normal science. Structures mentions both of those first two possibilities, but they are not the book's main concern. The main concern is scientific revolution. Scientific revolution, or paradigm shift, means the abandonment of the old paradigm and the adoption of a new one. And that is a key point Kuhn makes. Once it is achieved the status of a paradigm, a scientific theory is declared invalid only if an alternate candidate is available to take its place. Once a new paradigm is in place, the field returns once more to normal science, but it does so with a very different perspective. It never quite sees the old science in the same way again. I'll come back to that. A common critique of structure is that paradigm is poorly defined. We've already heard it described as a set of rules, but at some points Kuhn rejects that idea. Rules, he suggests, derive from paradigms, but a paradigm can guide research even in the absence of rules. One of the first definitions given is that of a universally recognised scientific achievement that for a time provides a model problems and solutions to a community of practitioners. But this is quickly clarified. A paradigm is rarely an object for replication. Instead, it is an object for further articulation and specification under new or more stringent conditions. At other times it becomes work that has been done once and for all. And sometimes it is defined by its effect. Inevitably, those restrict the phenomenological field accessible for science at any given time. At others, Kuhn presents it as the collective effect of law, theory, application, and instrumentation together. If you focus too much on this, it will bother you far more than it ought to. It clearly came to bother Kuhn himself. The author spends most of the 1969 postscript disentangling definitions. It is more useful to recognise that individual paradigms are not particularly hard to delineate historically, but as each consists of a web of interlocking theories, laws, applications, methods, concepts, observations, instruments, teachings, and problems, they resist general definition, because each is specific to its own historical moment. In exactly the same way that we have no difficulty delineating a particular social movement, ideology, or genre, but a great deal of difficulty in defining those terms. What matters is that examples proliferate of something that works in the way the model describes. Note that in saying this, I am dismissing most of the critics who have made accusations of ambiguity. I think it is a hard charge to maintain. A more reasonable charge, occasionally made, is that the definition of paradigm is a little bit circular. It is whatever fits in that place in the model, and whatever fits in that place does what the model suggests, precisely because it fits. There is one final note worth making. Whenever Kuhn speaks about paradigms in the abstract, it is usually plural, but particular historical examples tend to be singular. This creates a disconnect. Structure clearly implies that any particular scientist operates under the influence of multiple intersecting paradigms at any one time, but the impression given by examples, and this is how it is usually read, is that each scientific field is dominated by a single, all-encompassing paradigm at any moment. Structure is divided into 13 short sections. Ignoring the first, which is concerned with history of science, the others essentially divide into three parts. Sections 2 to 4 introduce the concept of normal science and make clear not only that normal science represents the bulk of scientific work, but also the most important part of it, while sections 5 through 9 explore the process of scientific revolution. The final sections, 10 through 13, are about understanding paradigms as worldviews and introduce the concept of incommensurability, which is used for the first time in section 10 as follows. As the problems change, so often does the standard that distinguishes a real scientific solution from a mere metaphysical speculation, word game, or mathematical play. The normal scientific tradition that emerges from a scientific revolution is not only incompatible, but often actually incommensurable with that which has gone before. It is not simply that you now know that light is not corpuscles, that chemicals do not have affinities, that there is no phlogiston or ether. It is that from the new perspective, the old explanation makes no sense, even if judged solely by the old evidence. This has frequently brought a charge of relativism against the final sections because it creates a problem with the logic of how one paradigm replaces another that is particularly bothersome from a philosophical point of view. But it is, again, this is a recurring feature necessary to explain a historical observation. Kuhn quotes a famous remark by Max Planck. A new scientific truth does not triumph by convincing its opponents and making them see the light, but rather because its opponents eventually die and a new generation grows up that is familiar with it. It is a very famous remark, and its empirical observation requires explanation. If it were possible to evaluate the merits of two paradigms independent of the paradigms themselves, and finding such a criteria has been a major goal of philosophy of science, then virtually all practitioners would abandon the inferior concept for the superior one. But they don't, or at least they don't sufficiently frequently to justify it as a problem. Kuhn's notion of incommensurability offers an explanation, albeit a controversial one, which brings us to a really central issue that you need to bear in mind when reading structure. Is this philosophy or history of science? It is useful when considering that to distinguish the author from the work. Kuhn began his career as a physicist. By 1952, a decade before structure was published, he had begun to write papers on history of science. But a few years after its publication, he accepted a position teaching philosophy. Over his career, he ran a gamut from practitioner through two very different types of commentator. And structure sits oddly in that trajectory, addressing a philosophical question, but as many readers have noted, with few philosophical references. There is a brief description of Karl Popper's equally influential falsifiability hypothesis, but an offhand remark elsewhere suggests why structure has so little time for this idea. Note the standard philosophy is held to, not internal coherence, logic, or some other philosophical standard, but a historical one of did this actually happen? And if frequency of citation is a guide, it is historical detail above all that shaped structure. Of the 13 most frequently cited works, 9 of them are not only histories, but they are histories published in the 1950s, only a short time before the book itself. Structure can be seen not as originating a historical re-evaluation of scientific progress, but as reflecting a change in the practice of history of science, something which is mirrored in the mid-20th century in the history of medicine. Structure is trying to offer a historical answer. What happened, and how do we explain the detail? Not a prescriptive model of what should be done, which is why the later Kuhn, the philosopher of science, is in many ways not particularly interesting or informative on the book's subject. He increasingly views it from the same disciplinary perspective as many of his critics. Addressing structure from the point of view of philosophy of science is entirely legitimate, but it should always be done with great care, recognizing that the book is the product of a different discipline. Now, I think there is an important issue with structure which is not always given enough thought. If it is primarily a work of history, how should we evaluate its attempt at generalization? Let us, for a moment, for the sake of argument, assume that Kuhn's model of paradigm crisis and revolution is an accurate description of all the historical examples he elicits as evidence. How many historical examples does he actually give? Since Darwin's Origin of Species is really only used as a metaphor for the approach Kuhn wants to take, I think it boils down to theories of light, the motion of bodies, astronomical discoveries, early research on electricity, and the displacement of phlogiston theory by Dalton's atomic chemistry. Except the last, these are all, with some anachronism, usually thought of as physics. And if we look at the 10 most frequently cited scientists, excluding Aristotle and Ptolemy, who are referenced primarily for their rejection by others, then we get a noticeable bulge in the 18th century, one that would be even more pronounced if we continued by adding de Coulomb, Fresnel, Proust, Scheele, and Young. So though it feels like structures offers a lot of examples, it really only draws on a particular type of science at a particular moment. Essentially, Enlightenment natural philosophy. Which for a historian raises an obvious question. Is Kuhn's model an accurate description of how scientists, in general, work, or simply a description of how some scientists worked at a particular point in the past? I am not going to presume to answer that here, but by historical standards, it is one of the most important questions that can be asked of the text. Whatever its merits, the structure of scientific revolutions is probably the single most influential work of history in the 20th century. That is indicated by the fact that it has altered our everyday language, but it is also apparent in reviews of the work. Most books receive reviews upon their publication, largely in proportion to the breadth of their potential audience and status of their author. Very few books receive multiple waves of reviews decades apart. But structure is not most books. With each of the first, second, and fourth editions in the 1960s, 1970s, and 2010s, it has been deemed significant enough to be widely reviewed. Reviews usually begin with a statement of the model, which is remarkably consistent across the decades. The first wave are a mixed bag, some enthusiastic endorsements, some critical rejections, and a number of dismissals that there is nothing new in the account. The second wave in the 70s do not have the option of direct dismissal, so the more critical ones adopt a new argument based on the 1969 postscript. They argue, with a rather convoluted logic, that the original model was wrong and that Kuhn now tacitly admits that, and therefore that both positions, structure itself, and Kuhn's 1969 statement, can be ignored. The third wave are most removed from conventional reviews. By the time the fourth edition was published, it was impossible to dismiss structure, however much a writer might disagree with it, and presumably few readers needed a summary. So reviews of the fourth edition turned into lengthy essays on a particular hobby horse for the writer, often only tangentially related to the original book. At the end of each episode, I suggest a reading, if you don't have time for the whole text, which of course you might not with a group of students. There is no section that covers every aspect of Kuhn's model, in part because it introduces its core concepts, normal science, paradigms, subsequently anomaly and crisis, and only in the latter half, incommensurability, a little bit at a time. But the model isn't hard to explain, so you can set a reading that suits your own needs. I won't presume to make a recommendation for anthropologists or sociologists. I think it's relatively new fields that were influenced by, but not drawn on in the book. These are the positions from which structure will seem most dated, and any choice of reading should be based on the works that you will subsequently read and which elements of structures they are interested in. For historians, I think the most interesting question is the degree to which generalization is a legitimate use of historical evidence, and probably the most interesting section in that regard is section 6, which focuses on three specific discoveries: X-rays, Leyden jars, and oxygen. For philosophers, I suggest section 10, which introduces the concept of incommensurability. It is this concept which has most bothered philosophers, in part, I think, because they take a very different and much more absolute understanding than the historical approach in structure implies. But it also presents an interesting problem. What should a philosopher do when reality refuses to conform to their theories? What about scientists? Okay, one of the conceits of these episodes is if a work is important enough to feature, then by definition it deserves a reading. But that doesn't necessarily follow. Just because a work is influential or important, it doesn't mean it's particularly relevant to you. And I think this applies here. One of the central arguments developed in the latter half of structure is not simply that the stories scientists tell about their discipline are false, but that they are false in a way that is well suited both to a sense of progress and the performance of normal science. I get the point of telling a historian not to trust self-serving sources, or telling a philosopher to pay a bit more attention to reality. But what purpose is served in telling a young physicist that their understanding is a convenient pedagogical fiction? Surely anyone self-reflective enough to listen already realizes that, and it offers no improvement in their practice. After all, Kuhn did not become a better physicist as a result of writing structure. He became philosopher.